It's been really humbling to hear all the presentations, even before this, all your group presentations. I was also sitting in a group. So I think, and I'll be a little brief only, but I do want to share a few of my reflections, particularly from the context of where I see some of your recommendations are going for policy discourse, but also for feminist movement building, which are both very critical to me personally and politically. The person is political, of course, but also, and I think, I do want to confess also that when we are talking about rewiring women's rights debates in a digital age, I do know the first half a little better and the second half not that well. But I think even on Saturday when we were talking about the online is really a reflection of the offline, maybe I won't be so much off the mark. And maybe there won't be any short circuits also in the kind of connections that I'm making. But I think, so in terms of what I saw emerging from the strategies and the issues I won't go into because I'm not the best person, but in terms of strategies, I think there are different levels at which the recommendations have come in, which moving forward we should be considering. And I think, on Saturday also I heard these tensions, and today also I heard these tensions, is that how are we looking at technology, first of all? Is it a resource? Is it a commodity in the market? Is it a medium? And I think we are all interpreting it in very different ways. So first of all, I think even our recommendations are at different levels, therefore. You know, our responses are at different levels depending on how we are interpreting. So that's one thing that I wanted to flag. But fundamentally, also what I saw emerging from the group presentations was the articulation of rights, of citizenship, netizenship, whatever you call it, but fundamentally on rights, democratic functioning and governance. And I think there were two sort of threads in which the strategies were emerging, which looked at technology as a right and also technology for rights. And I think, again, when we strategize and we strengthen our interventions, let's think about both. And I think here also we've heard about various different ways in which let's look at technology as a right to start with. When we are talking about technology as a right in the very traditional human rights sense, therefore it fundamentally means there is a rights holder and there is a duty bearer, correct? And in the very typical sense, we know that the communities we work with or us as users, we are talking about ourselves and the communities we work with as the rights holders, and the state as a duty bearer, made a bit complicated by the role of the market, given the way the larger political economy of this technological infrastructure is, correct? So in that sense, I think there were many recommendations you had for the state as a duty bearer, whether it is in terms of regulation, sometimes at the cost of over-regulation. I could hear these debates also in the group where I was sitting. So I think these are also things to think about in terms of how do we define that regulatory role. You were talking about multi-stakeholder regulatory frameworks, which I think has a few important principles there. There was this whole issue of grievance redressal. There was this whole issue of violations. And also promotive measures, I think, the kind of efforts that USOF is doing or others. So these are also very much in the realm of promoting a technology, ensuring access, outreach, so all of that. So I think the role of the state is at all of these levels, which I think are important, but also enabling, because many of you also spoke about how policy regimes need to be more gender responsive and more pro-poor, pro-people. And I think that is another important role where you saw how technology as a right needs to be looked at by the duty bearer. From the rights holder's perspective, I think there were many, many other kinds of interesting recommendations of how, as rights holders, it's not only about access, but it's about creating the technology infrastructure. It's about being part of that knowledge creation. It's about saying that my knowledge is knowledge too, and I think these are all fundamental principles that I saw coming out from a lot of the recommendations that you put out. Technology for rights. I think there is a huge plethora of experiences that have been shared here, whether it's rights in the context of social audits and accountability, whether it's in the context of a Khabar Leheria kind of an example, whether it's in the context of community radio. Portals, some of the recommendations you were making were also web portals where some of this information can be collated, something that the NMEW is already doing to some extent. We spoke about apps. So I think there is all of this wide range of using technology for rights, but I do want to bring it back to something that was also being discussed on Saturday, is when we are talking about the use of technology for rights, who is using it? How are we using it? For what purpose is it being used? And ultimately, what is the politics behind it? I think there is no getting away from us asking that question to ourselves again and again. Are we just making one piecemeal intervention in the larger scheme of things? Or what is the larger, what is the big picture really? In terms of our being able to push certain agenda. I think gender trainings and sensitization came up, something the women's movements have been doing for the last 40 years, and I always say we'll be doing it for the next 140 years, and that will still not be enough. And I do believe it's a very critical strategy. I mean, I know a lot of people may not agree with it. I am of the firm belief that gender sensitization of relevant stakeholders at all levels, including within civil society. I mean, it's also between movements, women's movements and other democratic movements. And so I think that engagement is also an important area of building the discourse. Because ultimately, I think I would just like to put my last set of thoughts on why I think it's important for us, even before we move into policy and legal frameworks, for us to really strengthen the movements or the understanding of women's organizations and civil society organizations on this whole issue, because it is at a very nascent stage. I think we are all still talking tangentially. I think we are still interpreting a lot of the concepts that we assume are common are actually not interpreted commonly. And I do therefore think that there is a value in courses like this where we are clarifying those, we are teasing them out, we are looking at academic work, but we are also looking at what is happening on the ground as practitioners in order to really strengthen our positions. And I sometimes feel that that is really the first step sometimes in terms of moving forward and building a political constituency or even clarity on what is the agenda, really, I mean, that we are trying to push. What is the change that we want to see? Fundamentally, I think that is a question that I keep coming back to. And while that change we want to see maybe at different levels, I think the kind of power equations within which we operate are something that have come up again and again. And I really think there's no getting away from it. And I do think that Even strategies like networking and building alliances and putting out information are not devoid of their internal power dynamics of who has access to what. I think that day, Norti ji also very clearly said, you know, you're talking about only 20% and what of the other 80%. So I think there is all of these that we have to keep coming back to as people who really want to make that change. So that's why I do think that, I mean, my thoughts are a little scattered, but I do think that these are some of the threads that I picked up and I do think that our coming together and talking about it and teasing things out is in itself the most valuable thing, the most valuable strategy, I would say, for me to take forward So just coming from where I'm coming, that is something that I thought that I would say. And yeah, I think that's mostly it. But the other thing I also wanted to say is in terms of the recommendations, I didn't see it come out very clearly from some of the groups, or maybe it did, but the whole issue of how whatever we are saying really has to be facilitated, and there has to be investments, there has to be funding, there has to be support for some of the work that we're doing, whether it is for creating platforms like this, whether it is for research, whether it is for creation of newer technologies, whether it's for generating data, whether it's for grassroots mobilization or whatever, training. And I do think that in terms of state policy, there is huge potential from a 27,000 crore scheme, and somewhat smaller 200 crore scheme for women. I mean, there's also this other bias in funding for women. No, we all know that. We all do gender budgeting, and you know, 90% of the budget of the Women and Child Ministry also goes only to child. So where is the woman? So just understanding some of that and looking at where the opportunities are available within state policy that we can leverage on should be an important exercise that we need to do a mapping, I think. And that is another thing that I would recommend that we do moving forward collectively or individually or organizationally, just in terms of being able to map some of those opportunities where we can really take some of these ideas as pilots, as moving from pilots to upscaling, and really taking it ahead. Yeah.